See, you are having a huge amount of data. You want to process them using one of the big data systems altogether. Okay. Now, point is, you must have heard about batch processing and real-time processing itself, right? So, what exactly are the best examples for it? So, guys, batch processing, when you typically talk about it, I would, let me just give you one simple example altogether. Let's say, you are having your retail industry. I'll give you the example of retail industry. You are having your stock ledgers, your general ledgers. They are the typical ledgers which are there in any of the retail industry, major you will talk about, even in the, they are common concepts in the banking industry as well. But let's say in the terms of, you know, this specific retail thing. Now, so what exactly happens on the stock ledger side and all? Those stock ledgers are something which typically have the inventory information altogether, right? With the store, this particular division, this particular, you know, item, this many number of, overall quantities available and the kind of price and etc., etc. And this stock ledger is something which keeps getting updated every day, right? Based what exactly sales have happened, is there any defects, is there any theft, you know, and all that, right? So they just keep getting updated, and then at the end of the business day, you have to close your business, and before you start next day's business, all of this has to be consolidated, and your kind of, you know, targets, whatever are there, are there are any kind of forecasts, financial reporting basically. So if there are any kind of forecasts or if there are any kinds of targets which you have to set, they have to be updated before the next business day starts. And what is the best way to do that? The best way to do that is take all of the transactions which have happened in a day. You don't really need to do all of this again and again in a day, right? You have to do it once in a day before the, you know, next business day starts. And so basically when the today's business day ends and before the next business day starts, right? In between, you have to do this process once. Are you all getting the point? Guys, are you all getting this point? So if you talk about this, this typically that the processing which you would do in this case is once in a day. It's kind of a batch processing altogether, right? Now, when you talk about, guys, are you all hearing me? I mean, I'm not really sure whether I'm getting your response or not. Okay. Great. Yeah. Thanks. So, you know, your response actually tells me whether it is clear or not, or if there is any question, it can be answered. Right? Now, so batch processing is going to be your, you know, preferred way. So when you talk about the big data applications and all, it's the preferred way of processing huge amount of data. And typically what happens is you group a lot of transaction over a defined period, right? Basically, it's going to be the frequency of a batch job, once in a day, weekly, or whatever, twice in a day kind of a thing, right? So you'd be collecting that huge amount of data, processing it in a given batch window, right? So batch window means in a the time period in which the batch runs. So that is typically called a batch window. And Hadoop is the best. So Hadoop is typically used for the batch processing, nothing new. Examples, I think like financial reporting, forecasting, dynamic pricing. Though dynamic pricing in some cases it has become kind of real time as well, but or probably almost real time. I'll come to that when I'll talk about the real time processing, right? So they are typically called the batch processing kind of systems, and we are quite well versed with them. And we are using Hadoop also for them since quite a long time. Not a problem at all, right? Now, if we just move, it's a very generalized kind of way. So you might be having multiple data, sources all together, social data, BI data, operational data, etc., etc., etc. You must be putting them into, your data lake if I don't call it as data lake, let's say in a very simple manner, you're just Hadoop itself, your typical ETL of processes which will be applied, and then you will be doing whatever analytical functions you want to do, right? So good thing, but the so what really happens in this case is something like it. Just a second, guys. I don't want to cover real-time processing right now. Okay. I will come back to this slide, guys. I will come back to the slides which I just skipped. Okay. So what really happens in this case? In this case, let's say if you look at about the data, this is your input data, right? Input data kind of in a timeline, and this is your processing timeline. So assuming that it's a daily process, so whatever is the input data of day one, that is going to be processed in day two, and basically it's going to be one day delay altogether, right? So all the time, if I'm looking at the data, if I'm looking at some of the report right now, I am quite sure that things have changed, right? So the data which I'm looking right now versus whatever is the actual, whatever should be the actual view, it's kind of a stale view, right? I'm not getting a fresh view all the time or hot view all the time, right? It is just that I'm getting some sort of pre-processed data up to a certain frequency, which might be a day older, which might be some 2-3 hours older kind of thing, right? Depending upon what is the frequency and all, right? So this is quite good for batch processing, but now let us take a step back, okay? Let us take a step back and talk about real-time processing. Now, when you talk about real-time processing, first of all, before I read any of these points, let me explain that real-time processing is nothing but it's a myth. There is nothing called real-time processing in big data world. Okay, there is absolutely nothing called real-time processing. At max, it is near real-time processing. Okay, so seems like somebody is saying something. Streaming. Again, Satish, these are different ways. I will come to that. You'll realize it is Spark as well. Streaming is big. Okay, but point is, be it streaming, be it Hadoop streaming, be it the streaming way you know, or be it the Spark streaming, all of them are the example or the best examples for near real-time processing. They are not at all the examples of real-time. Let me tell you one of the examples which which I have implemented in one of the banks altogether. But before that, let me just tell a bit more about real-time processing. So real-time processing itself is all about your data processing is gonna continue. Okay, it's not like it's gonna work on a continual input altogether, and it's going to work on those small chunks of the data, and it will keep on outputting the data again and again. So the idea here is, in the batch processing, your applications were running again and again in the larger interval, whereas here the interval itself is going to be very small. Okay, so your program is going to execute again and again, but in that delta time, whatever is the extra amount which came, you immediately process it and show the output. Now, this is the basic difference here. You talk about real-time processing. When you talk about real-time processing here, most of the applications, I mean, you can modify them, but at the very essence, most of these real-time, so-called real-time applications are for the sliding window type of operations. Okay, so most of these are suitable for the sliding window operations altogether. So for example, trending topics in last 1 hour, right? Or trending topics in whatever last n number of minutes altogether. This is a sliding window kind of operation, right? Wherein right now, probably, I'm just giving an example, okay? So probably up to yesterday night, Mr. Narendra Modi's US visit was a trending topic in Facebook. in most of the social media, right? I'm just giving one example. But from 12 o'clock up to, let's say, morning 4 o'clock, there was an incident in India. Some accident happened, or I don't know, some other thing, right? Dashera celebrations and other things, right? So they have just started here itself. So this has become a trending topic altogether, right? So if you look at it, what happened before that was not really a problem. So if you look at it from the batch processing perspective, if you had to implement these kind of trending topic kind of, you know, algorithms altogether in a batch processing way, probably you might not be getting the latest picture. But if you have to do these sliding window operations, typically you would like to go for something called near real-time processing kind of systems altogether, right? Or if there, let's say there is an event, number of tweets which come on the top of it, right? This is the real-time processing kind of examples. So here the data processing is typically much smaller. It's going to be in usually in the fractions of seconds, and as compared to the batch processing, because there the batch window will be at the fastest would be several minutes, right? The typical use case of real-time, or assume that I'm talking about near real-time, okay? So about the real-time systems would be CEP platforms altogether, complex event processing kind of platforms. So what is the best example of it? Okay, so the best example of it is, though we have not implemented any big data solution for that, it's kind of a cousin of Storm in which I have implemented. It's called Esper. Okay, so what sorry, what happens is, let's say you are doing a transaction, okay, credit card transaction, simple, and online, let's say you are purchasing something, you provide your credentials, whatever XYZ, and everything is well, you are well within your limits, you are buying something, your credentials and everything, whatever you have provided, is good, and the transaction happens successfully. Okay, so for example, right now you have done a transaction, very good, everything goes well in the banking world altogether, good. Now let's say 1 hour later, one more transaction happens on your credit card. Okay, credentials and everything is good, everything is good. Okay, again the transaction, next transaction, whatever is happening, again falls within the credit limit, no problems at all, everything is good. Okay, but there is one thing, that the first transaction, the geographical data, which when you agree that, okay, I'm ready to share my location, right? And when you are sharing your location, it found that the first transaction originated in Delhi. Okay, but the second transaction 1 hour later is happening somewhere in Mumbai, right? Now it is physically impossible for a person to be there at two different places at the same time, right, guys? I hope you are understanding the point, right? So now if this thing has to be detected, right, so even if everything is good, but if the geographical data shows something, now there must be a program. I'm just giving a hint, I mean, we have implemented it in that way, okay? So there must be a program which will continuously run on a stream of data which is coming again and again, right? So, and this program might be somewhere before your request is sent to the payment gateway, right? If that program boolean returns yes, then send it to the payment gateway. If that program boolean output is false, then either reject it or send it to something called referral, right? Referral means, what would happen in that case, as soon as the transaction would happen, you will get a call on your registered number, okay, saying that, sir or ma'am, we are seeing this particular transaction happening right now on your card with this thing. Is this you who is doing the transaction? Has it happened with any of you? Because the bank for which I have implemented is a renowned bank. That would give you the idea as well. So anyway, for the process is, they are now planning to move it on a larger scale. It was a POC. So not many of you might have got it, but yes, it was implemented for some certain reasons. And then I think it is in the process of Bank of America as well. Might be Satish, right? So there are several, but I'm just sharing my experience, right? Okay, now let me just quickly come back. So those kind of systems are called complex event processing platforms. Now look at it. This the focus point is not really the implementation. The focus point is look at the way you are going to process your transactions. You are interested only in present. You are interested in seeing that, okay, what is this transaction which is coming at, and that's it. You don't really care about what happened in past, what will happen in future, right? There was one program which was written and which was just seeing that, okay, whenever a transaction comes, just look at it, the last transaction and the time and if whatever, right? And then just see that if that is good, good. Otherwise, you know, just send the request for the referral altogether, right? They don't really care about past, or they don't really care about the future. That is the basic difference altogether of the you know, real-time processing systems altogether, right? So I have not covered this part. Okay, I'm not trying to confuse you here. It's all about you will be having multiple data platforms, then there would be a shared metadata kind of a layer. These are typical ways, okay, these are typical ways in which, you know, you create your real-time systems, and then your small real-time systems would just be working on this data, shared metadata altogether. They would be working, and then they would be generating some sort of notifications. Okay, so most of the times your real-time systems or so-called real-time systems are used for the event processing or for the event notification and not really any processing. So any processing, when you talk about the processing of calling you, confirming the things and all happened by some other bank enterprise system, right? Your real-time enterprises, your real-time you know, big data system didn't do anything. Are you getting my point? Your real-time big data application didn't do anything other than passing the request to the right person, passing the request to the right application altogether, and that's it. Its scope is over. Is that clear to everybody? The basic difference, the way you should go for your problems, right? And also it's called real time also because there is no point of saying that this was a fraud transaction when the transaction has happened, right? All of the referral has to happen before your request goes to the payment gateway, right? All of this. So that's why people call it as a real time system, right? So these are some of the things where you have to think. So when you are going to apply Spark, right? Spark in some cases can be used for real-time processing, but most of the places its typical use case is going to be very fast batch processing. Okay, so I would give you another best example for which we are kind of, so there are two POCs. One is in the, we are about to productionalize it, and another one is in the POC stage wherein we are just trying to enhance it a bit more. So one is called dynamic pricing. I am sure I am not going to spend much time on the dynamic pricing. It's all about you know, that depending upon the demand, your inventory you know, prices have to be dynamic. They have to change very, very fast. Okay, so that was the place wherein we have applied Spark processes, and they have kind of, you know, so now basically this retailer, I can't name it right now, but this retailer has now applied this dynamic pricing module, and it runs kind of every half an hour. Earlier it used to run once in a day, and then when it went to Hadoop, it was running thrice in a day. Okay, but now with that, it is running every half an hour, and they are able to get much better responses or much better margins altogether. Okay, so this is just one example. I'm just giving you one example about the suitability. See, more than the language itself or more than the framework itself, these kind of questions will come to you when you will be implementing these. Should I implement, or is this the best fit, right? So just keep these things in your mind, and that's why this entire discussion, one time discussion, is happening with you. Okay, so Hadoop for batch processing, I'm not spending much time on it. It's about so the overall purpose of keeping it here only is for those people who are not aware of Hadoop, right? There are several here. So HDFS, it's the storage layer, and we have covered only Hadoop 2.0. We are not showing Hadoop 1.0 because that's the way forward, right? Yarn, that's your cluster resource management, and then you have MapReduce framework on the top of which, you know, Pig and Hive can run, and then you have other Yarn frameworks, right, which are like your Giraffe, your Spark, right, and there are several others as well, Pregel, Dremel, etc., which can run on the top of it, and then you have HBase, which kind of, you know, directly interacts with HDFS without Yarn, and this remains unchanged till now as well, right? So this is something wherein your typical, you know, the Hadoop ecosystem is, and on the top of it you are saying Uzi, it's all about your workflow scheduler. So in a job you might do some sort of scoop and then do some sort of pig processing and probably you know, persisting some data into HBase and then doing some kind of fetching it, right, into, let's say, a UI. You want to do these things in one by one order, and if there is any failure, you want some sort of decision points, etc. Those are some of the things which you can do in workflow scheduler, which is Uzi, right? So I'm not spending much time into it. I hope everybody understands it, right?